All right. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Hope you're doing well on this fine Thursday. Thanks everybody for being here. I just wanted to see if we can hear everybody all right. We can just go around the room and I figured we can just start by introducing everybody up on stage, and then we'll just have like a brief announcement, and then we'll just jump right into it. Hey Beth, how are you doing? Good morning.
Hi, good morning. I'm Beth. I'm lead of ambassadors for FSL. I don't have much NFT experience besides having a whole bunch of Steppin sneakers. I'm excited to learn, but I'm also very excited about more and all of the possibilities and features that it has. And that's about me.
Yeah, thanks for being here. And we're definitely excited to talk a bit more about it. How are you doing, Victor? I see you out there.
GM, GM, everybody. I'm doing good. It's been a great morning. Had a little space, GM space with the community. And yeah, GM, everybody. My name is Victor. I'm just someone you know. And I'm a founder of Stone Tigers. I'm doing NFTs for a little over a year. And all I do is NFTs every single day. And that's it. I'm here on Twitter without days off since 1st August last year. And now, yeah, I'm just someone you know, and I appreciate you all.
A true builder in a space and NFT enjoyer, I see. I love to see it. How are you doing, Q?
What is up, guys? I'm calling in from Barcelona. I hope that my audio is great. But if I do drop off, just a heads up, I will be back. I'm doing great. I am founder of Particles. We are an on-chain art gallery and museum of digital fine art. And for the past 9 months, I've just had the pleasure of supporting. On doing that for the next foreseeable future of my life. So I'm very excited to be here. Thank you guys for having me.
Amazing. Yeah, no, we appreciate having you up here and taking the time out to talk to us a bit more about your project. How are you doing, Marcus? Do you want to give a brief introduction to yourself? Gorgeous day, God, by the way.
Hey guys, Marcus here. I write for Steppin and I've been involved in the NFT space for about a year now. So really excited to be here.
Yeah, awesome. We're definitely happy to have you here. And one thing I wanted to mention before we jump right into it. So, live after this Twitter space, we're actually giving away 300 GMT. So all you have to do is go to the more official account that's hosting and retweet the pinned tweet, tune in live, stay tuned in for the Twitter space, and like the tweet and comment below. Either some thoughts about the founders, more maybe questions you have, or anything else you want to share on this beautiful Thursday.
Yeah, just pin it at the top for everyone to see. So there is another giveaway I'm also doing. I'm gonna give away Stone Tiger for somebody in the room.
Oh,
Yeah, just
awesome.
retweet everything pin up top here, guys.
Amazing. Yeah, and for those of you who don't know me, my name's Trevor. I work as the head of business development right now for Steppin. And on that note, let's dive right into it. So I just wanted to start by learning a little bit about your projects, Victor and Q. So Victor, if you want to start by just giving us a little bit insight on the motivation behind your project and maybe why you started it.
Yeah, of course, 100%. So when I joined NFT originally, I became a part of a few different communities. And what I figure out for me is that there never was one that I truly enjoyed being a part of, like where I can feel myself being myself. So I decided to create one. And I thought for a second, okay, what the things that I love and know as a culture? And I've been completely honest to myself. I say, well, I'm smoking weed for over a decade, and that's pretty much the only culture that I truly know, being a stoner. And then I'm born in Chinese Year of Tiger. So it's another part of me, which, you know, today is a wonderful community with almost 500 holders, a sold out collection. There's over 3,000 of us in the Discord. And I'm here just talking to you all. And yeah, one day it was just an idea, create something that never existed as a whole, as a community. And I'm happy to be here with all of you guys, with all the Tigers. We wanted to be a community-driven project, and we became one. Our community take the huge part in everything we're doing. For example, right now we started the art contest for the holders, artists of our community that can basically create their own trades and submit like three for every holder to actually be voted by our community and then implemented into the generation. So that's just another cool thing. We truly want the people around us to be a part of what we're doing, because I have no idea where the industry will be like in 5 years from now. I know where we want to be as a brand, but I don't know how the NFTs will be, right? And I believe we all together collectively with another over 400 people can figure out way better than me alone. And so far that's been true. So never generated hype, but we build a community and we got a people around us that do care and that enjoy being a part of it. And we also have our co-founder, Maria, right now on the stage with us as a Stone Tigers. So make sure to follow. And we started also Sweep the Floor contest. You can go and snipe these bad boys in Magic Eden or OpenSea on Solana.
Awesome. Yeah, no, that's definitely, that's an amazing story. It's funny how like it started from just a simple idea, and to see how large of a community that you've, you know, like cultivated since like the beginning is incredible. And I think that's something about NFTs that none of us really expected. Welcome, Maria, by the way. It's good to have you up on stage.
Hi.
Yeah. Hi, Maria.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I see a lot of tigers here in the room. It's nice to see you too. Thanks for coming, guys. I'm just Maria. I go by Aninhas here in the space. And I'm like the co-founder. So basically what I do, I just do like the job of a community builder, moderator, and I organize the events and all of that together. And I've been doing it since January, so it's been almost a year now. And I work on it every day, like just like Victor, we work on it together. And it's pretty cool, we're enjoying the process. And yeah, thank you for having us.
Yeah, absolutely. No, we appreciate having you here. And it's, you know, definitely amazing that you've just been building this space for such a long time too. I think some people are definitely new around these parts and maybe not as familiar with some of the other, so many NFTs in the space to keep up with. It's really difficult because there's so many people building out there in different communities. So I was curious to hear as well about just the motivation cue on founding Particles and just like when you got started with that.
Yeah, 100%. I think ultimately we were always a bit of like a black sheep when it came to NFTs, because when I came around to the Solana ecosystem, there wasn't really a one of one art community there. It was like 20 people and we were all in like one spaces, just talking and caring about this thing. But ultimately I kind of had the foresight to see that on Ethereum, original like on-chain art from artists, painters, sculptors had blown up and was a giant market over there. And it was only a matter of time until that would happen on Solana. And so we set out on this mission to say, hey, we're extremely early. I know that a lot of collectors at that point were all mostly flipping. And we were like, we'll be the geeks. We'll do all the research. We'll tell you and like give you the alpha on one of one artwork and collect it as a community so that we can have this like museum of digital fine art. And in 5 years down the line, we're all going to make history together. And a bunch of people decided that that was an exciting mission for us to embark on. And so over the past 9 months, we minted out in February. We ended up collecting over 1,000 Solana worth of artwork. And I guess the beautiful thing about this as well is that ultimately we believed that the bull market wasn't going to last forever. And we knew that artwork is always going to be not correlated to the overall markets. And so I'm very happy and proud to like say that we've actually helped hedge a lot of people's exposure to the overall markets, because as the bear market has gotten like closer and closer to the bottom, I hope art has only increased in value, and there's only been an exponential growth in the amount of people who have come into this ecosystem and called it home. And so that's ultimately why we did this, is we knew that it was only a matter of time, and we wanted to support artists in the earliest stages and share in the success that they're seeing now.
Yeah, that's a really exciting journey. And I remember it's just crazy that it's already November 17th. You're one of the few projects where I was actually there at Mint, and I held probably through and through. Because I believed in like the community and like your mission for supporting a lot of artists in this space. And I've seen what you guys have like done since then. It's incredible to see, you know, communities and NFT projects like yourself start so early and, you know, build this large like digital community of people online that really seek to just like support and like lift each other up. And definitely in the artist space, you know, like you and like Victor's projects, like they definitely stand out in terms of supporting artists. I've seen you guys like time and time again doing like amazing collaborations with others. You know, you're not just like out for yourself and always looking to see how you can like continue contributing maybe to like other projects and also build up your community and others at the same time. So that's a really amazing. It's amazing that you guys are still around and here in the NFT space too. I think especially recently we've seen the challenges with some obviously in like the market and just like the market cycles and the contractions of like last like bear and bull and bear. So it's, you know, we love that you're still around here and building. And on that, I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of just like how you were getting ready to like launch your project, and how you're preparing, like how much initially you had set out maybe like on your roadmap, and like I don't know how much time you set out on your initial roadmap, and then like what has changed on the roadmap like since then. If you wouldn't mind just giving like a very brief summary, and then also how central of like a role where did royalties play as a part when you're thinking about your initial roadmap, and then like, you know, how did you think about it then, and like how are you thinking about it now? Either of you can kind of dive in first, feel free.
Well, I can start. Yeah. First of all, like preparing for the launch, right? So that's a great question. And for us, for me personally, when I started in this space, I had zero money, zero connections, zero knowledge. So I had to learn it all because I couldn't afford to pay to anybody for anything. And what I did is went on the Twitter spaces, went meeting people and building up a community, just meeting other influencers along the way, other project founders, other projects. And yeah, I mean, we spent zero budget on marketing, in fact, because we had zero. And launched the collection at 420, because it's April 20, kind of very known number for all the stoners. And I cannot say that was a good idea because there has been a lot of people minting at the same exact date. And that was a huge downside. Well, that was expectable, right?
Yeah,
a lot of people could say, but
you had a lot of competition too, right?
Hell yeah.
You had Best Buds. You also had Mary Jane. You had a lot of other people in the space sort of like trying to build, some with that community with those members.
Right. But then, the community is a global thing. It's not that it belongs to just one project, because people, if they are in NFTs, they hold multiple NFTs. And if they like a certain direction of the culture, they will be primarily looking at those ones. But then, because it created a lot of noise during this day, that was very harsh. But anyways, that's how we went into, the preparation. And then there is a lot of things that happen along the way where I can say that the roadmap and that originally being projected, it's more like a direction. It cannot be exact because you don't know 100% if the market will need it and if the people will want it. So what we still need to do is update our roadmap, like the general direction, instead of actually specifying the things in it, because there's a lot of things changed since the community voted, on changing it up into one way or another, and etc. And then a lot of side utilities that being accumulated over the course of all this time through the strategic partnerships is just incredible. So there is so many things that wasn't originally on the roadmap that bring so much value already in it, even right now, during the bear market, during the bull market, doesn't matter. I believe that's what's important to actually, build a sustainable ecosystem where the people do know each other, talk to each other and collaborate, because it's a global thing. It's not as much on the competition level. I mean, but when you're launching the same day, that's where the competition comes in, because the people need then twice more liquidity to get two projects instead of one in the same period of time, which may be complicated. But then if you think as an industry as a whole, if somebody likes weed-related NFTs, it's good if this person will have all of them, because at least, let's say, five of them going to appreciate and they're going to be happy that they succeeded onto the culture that they truly love. So that's what I can say about it. And there was a third question. I'm not sure if you could retweet it, because
yeah,
I forgot a little bit.
I appreciate the insight a bit on the on your like initial roadmap. I was just asking about how much did you like consider royalties as a part of when you're factoring in like creating your initial roadmap, let's say, or did
right.
you think about it a lot? Because I know you said you started right, and you had and this is true, I think, for a lot of people in this space. So, there's obviously, it's a hot debate about royalties right now in among every, not just NFT marketplace, but also a lot of existing NFT projects and new NFT creators in the space. And so I was curious, you said you had like zero budget early on, right? I mean, that must have been a major challenge. So like, were you thinking a lot about royalties and
All right, so there are a few things to the royalties in general. It's bad for the ecosystem, what's happened with the royalties, and I believe they're going to be reinforced on the chain still, and there's going to be more marketplaces that are going to come up with the enforcement of the royalties. And that's not a big issue on the long run. In the short term, it actually harms more our community than the projects, because the people understand the importance of paying royalties when they flipping NFT. If it's not like a crazy amount of money, we say of like, buying monkey business and then you have to buy and then pay royalties as well on top, it adds up, it's like bigger number. Where if it's a cheaper project for you, it's okay, and you understand the value that it brings to, the creators. So the majority of people still deciding to pay the royalties. But for the art world, it's different, because if they're optional, the people, may be very unhappy about it. They will just go to other blockchains, to other platforms, and that's it. So these users will leave you. But did it affect anyhow us in general, and how? Well, we plan originally to, be using royalties for sponsoring the live events, and then for, providing an additional giveaways and etc. to the community, doing some contests and like a fun stuff for the community. Where if that completely goes off, of course that gotta be very sad and a little bit painful, because we will need to find this budget in other places. But it's not the end of the day, you know. It's like, it's all the game and whatever. It's like, if they do that, okay, we're gonna find another ways. But the royalties for some project played like the very major role, because they based out of the royalties and the secondary utility of them. So we just never build our project this way. And in case somebody did, that's where the problems comes in, because now you gotta like completely change a lot that you projected on, where for us it's more of the site things and additional activities that we could provide of using them. So it's better if we do have royalties paid, and if somebody buys Tiger, goes and pay royalties still, because then we accumulate another Solana, we can do another art contest for artists and give it away to somebody in the community, somebody that needs it more than us, in a sense. And, you know, they don't necessarily need to sell art to get appreciated and get exposure and still get paid. So, that's my take on that.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a good take. And I think that is certainly true, right? Like, the fact that you're sort of thinking about giving back to your community as you grow it at the same time, and others who you may want to like join and grow with the community, and you're kind of using royalties in order to do that, or as a means to help like support and lift you up early on as a project, which is definitely, you know, true for a lot of people and like early creators too in the space. Yeah, so I appreciate the take on that. Yeah, so Q, I think, I mean, just kind of coming back to like the two questions, did your roadmap change like a lot, like from day one to like, you know, today? And also along there, if you want to just like speak to how much you maybe like thought about royalties playing a role early on when you're creating your roadmap, and how they continue to maybe play a role in your project today. And I know, you know, from context and your roadmap, it's definitely a lot involved. You have like particles and a lot of staking. You've launched a token, right? I mean, there's a lot of moving pieces and parts to consider, and especially like how you like use the funds, just like Victor's talking about how he maybe uses the funds. So I'm eager to hear your perspective.
Yeah, for sure. So initially, when we set out to, you know, mint and created our roadmap, royalties was a big part of that plan. And so we had that 50% of royalties were going to go towards collecting artwork perpetually for our gallery and museum. And then 50% was going to go towards the operations of the business. We did a good job at like generating volume up until the point, you know, when they all went to zero. And by that time, we'd actually completed a lot of our roadmap. So on our original plan, we said, hey, we're going to collect 888 Solana worth of artwork. We actually ended up going over 1,000 because we were, you know, ultimately making a return on the artwork that we purchased. It was appreciating in value. We had gotten the hang of it.
That's incredible, by the way, especially to make that that conviction play to like invest in a community and like other artists. And if you wouldn't mind too, just maybe you could also speak about sort of like your fractionalized art. I think that would help people understand maybe like why you're purchasing all this art too.
Yeah, definitely. And I think this is like the really interesting part about how we move forward, is that the way that I have kind of oriented Particles it to be now is, originally we had this vault of artwork, hundreds of pieces of artwork that would be redeemable in our token. So it's the first asset-backed token in Solana. It's not thin air. It's not us just creating a token because we wanted to create a token. Every single one of them is actually backed by the artwork that we own. And we distribute that ownership throughout our community via our NFTs and via staking. And so the new phase that we're kind of moving into is that we realized that it would be a little bit, it would take too long right now for them to redeem artwork solely in the one of one token. We call it OO. And so it will essentially serve as a discount rate for all of the artwork in our vault. And so because we have already done our roadmap, right? Like we made a gallery, we invested a thousand soul into artwork, we fractionalized it, we launched a token, we have auctions and raffles for artwork that are like stupid fucking like arbitrage when it comes to our community members actually obtaining the artwork that we've collected. And now we're thinking about, okay, we don't have royalties anymore. So how do we keep growing this museum? How do we keep growing our collection of artwork and still be able to benefit our community at the same time as capture on-chain history, art history, right? And so we have a catalog coming out. It's going to have over 200 pieces of artwork from the artists like Adam Ape, Degen Poet, John Lay, Maxwell Adams, any artist you can think of on Solana. And we have also a couple of them on Ethereum now, which I'm very excited about. But ultimately, by owning a particle, you are joining a curated collector community. And all of the pieces that we own are exclusively reserved for you as a holder. And so if in one of our collectors wants to make us an offer on our pieces, depending on the amount of one of one token that they have, it will then give them a very steep discount on that artwork. So you're actually the perfect example, Trevor, because last week we beta tested it with you, and a artwork that was worth, I think, 39 Solana at the time, you ended up paying 6 Solana for and joining Adam Ape's community. But obviously, you know, you've been one of our biggest supporters. You've been here since the beginning, since Mint, like you said. And for us, we had purchased for 6 Solana. So giving it for 6 Solana and still be able to capture that token back was a very easy decision on our end to make sure that we're always taking care of our holders, because there's more than enough to go around. We've been here the longest, and we don't plan on going anywhere.
Yeah, that's definitely amazing to hear. I was really excited, obviously, to start to, you know, see some like the value that I like invested in like your community and others, and how it just goes full circle with supporting other creators and artists in this space by like getting involved in your community. And then it puts me in touch with so many amazing other one of one artists, generative artists, like multiple edition collections, like Adam Ape, his like gorgeous animations, as well as others, that I've just like got in touch with and closer. And I think your project is a great example of like doing well, similar to like Victor, with you're taking some of your royalties, you're investing back in your community, you're purchasing art, you're connecting more of the digital communities online, all as a means to lift and like support creators up in like this new Web3 space, to give people, a place to share and create art and have other people like appreciate it. You know, I actually, before Web3, I was never one to like collect much art. I never had like a means or like too much of a passion, let's say, for a lot of physical art. I really like photography, but seeing a lot of all the art in the space and then connecting with people over crypto was just really exciting when like those two things like connected for me. I think a lot of other people are seeing that in the space too. So that's really awesome, especially.
Yeah. And I also love to like go in a little bit about how we plan on making revenue in the future. I definitely think that in this 0% royalty like environment, I'm not necessarily relying on any good actor in the space to like save us as a like project or community. What is really exciting is that because we've like built so much goodwill with our community, we're releasing a artist collaboration series with all of these artists. So our collection will be the largest collection of one of one particles. It's not going to be generative. It's going to be the work of hundreds of artists who have all created their own version of our pieces. And so I just want to shout out, like, there is an artist right now in the audience. Her name is Mila Gross. She has great fucking art. And we are going to be having an auction for Solana. And those particles that are minted will be added to our official hash list. And we will become essentially an infinitely expanding collection of NFT artists, collectors, and builders in the Solana space, a lot like Nouns DAO, for example.
Yeah, no, definitely appreciate the shout out. We definitely love supporting all the artists in the space. And I love that you guys continue to just look for ways to like give back and like share like with your community and like other communities. When I see that, it's definitely super exciting. I think it just like connects more of us online as well. Yeah, so one of like the next topics is, it's definitely, I think we got into it a little bit, but I just wanted to like get your hot take on royalties. I did want to mention that the new marketplace that Find Satoshi Lab launched, we're really passionate and excited, especially to like support creators and in the space launching new PFP projects. Like, we know it's like challenging and difficult, especially to like get that early traction. I mean, you can see it from the founders up on stage. And so that's why we're choosing to stand like with royalties. So like when projects launch with us, we'll definitely aim to enforce royalties on our NFT marketplace that aim to launch with us, to support them early on as they build out their roadmap and their vision. And, you know, sometimes projects, it's not always perfect, like early on. And if they don't have some of like, just like that initial support, then it could make or break their communities and also their product, perhaps like their vision long term. So I was curious, like, you know, what your take is on in the future, maybe let's say like if royalties, if we see, because we've seen some other marketplaces, maybe on and off set like royalties to zero. So, you know, what does that like mean for the space, and what are your thoughts on it from a marketplace perspective, and also like as a creator who lists art, let's say art or even, you know, just like your PFP collection on your marketplace?
Well, that's a good thing if the marketplace do have a royalties reinforcement. That's what I can say, because then there is a lot of, you know, additional little things that can be implemented based on that too. Even if volume is not big for the collection, it's just the fact that there's a little more that you could contribute because of that. And this is very cool. And a lot of artists will eventually pick up the marketplaces that do reinforce the royalties. And a lot of creators that will be, you know, creating a collection hugely based on the royalty side, they got to be making sure that, yeah, they go somewhere where the royalties are enforced and the people got to be paying them, as that how they're going to build XYZ for their holders. So it's very important. The royalties in general is what makes the space itself so desirable. I understand also, you know, the marketplaces that think, okay, so that got to bring more trading volume, because now for the traders, it's easier to trade and get a profitable trade. Yeah, of course, but you decide one side or another, community over traders or vice versa. I don't know how good of a community the traders are, but I know that the artists and, you know, people that are creating on the blockchain because of everything it has to offer are enjoying the royalties as one of the features that it has to provide. So without it, yeah, the space wouldn't be entirely the same. And I don't think so any people around want that. We have a lot of artists in our community, and, you know, it's for art. It's like, I think the royalty shall be even bigger than 10%, which is marketplaces not allowing you to have. It's It's like maybe 20% would be cool, at least you have 20. 10 is just so little. Imagine your artwork appreciated over the course of 5 years, but you started from zero, knowing nobody, and in the future, till showcasing your art in the galleries, you know. It's like it's a whole journey. And you get only 10% of a cut of the secondary sales. What if it sold for like 1,000 Ethereum? You got only, what, 100 of ETH out of 1,000? Well, it's a good money, yeah, but I mean, it's just a huge portion of it goes to the collector. I believe that the creators shall be getting paid over a course of time and building their careers. And it's the same with the founders of the project. We do want to get paid, and you know, 5 years from now, massively rewarding us as well for what we've been doing. And I don't think so it's fair to just take it away and make it optional. So that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah, I appreciate that hot take. I think we all have definitely seen the challenge with, you know, you sort of remove royalties from the equation. It's like, how do you continue to like support the project early on, and especially look to, you know, as a means to kind of incubate and also give some support from people that are, you know, buying and selling into your project as you continue to grow it. Q, what's your hot take? I feel like I might know, but I'm curious.
I have a super spicy take, and
here we go.
So ultimately, I think that the conversation around royalties is, to me, kind of like a little bit tired at this point, because A, it was never enforceable on the contract level, so it was inevitable to happen. And I think that ultimately, having centralized parties have control over the royalties is worse than having royalties and like begging these people not to be a bad actor. I think if anybody has control over the ability to set and take away royalties, that is inherently a flaw in the technology itself. And ultimately, I really think that when you're talking about generative and more PFP-esque projects, it's not necessarily an artist that's making it. It's more so a unregulated security that people are trading and treating like stocks. And so I think that when you have this royalty mechanism, you're incentivizing founders to treat their own companies like stocks before they've ever built a product. And so that's why we see all these giant pump and dumps where only substance a project is going to release is their marketing, because that generates volume and they still take all that volume home. And that doesn't necessarily create a positive net experience for the ecosystem. And so do I think that like artists who create paintings and sculptures and sell those should get royalties? Yes. But if you look in the ecosystem, Form Function Exchange and like the fine art marketplaces haven't changed their stance on royalties. It's realistically the marketplaces who allow people to, you know, speculate and go degen that ultimately want people to like degen on their platform rather than others. So it was inevitable. I don't really necessarily hate it or love it. I think it was really nice when we had royalties, but if it means that I have to kind of like adhere to somebody else's rules in a decentralized space, I think that more so defeats the purpose. And so I'm just moving forward with the assumption that nothing is promised and I'm gonna have to figure it out as a project for my community and for my team. And that's why I've focused so much on revenue generating activities during these times.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think you bring up a lot of the same challenges NFT projects are facing in space today. And I would tend to, you know, agree that like at the contract level, you look at, you know, some things that have tried to enforce royalties at that contract level, whether it's like, it's Cardinal or some others in the space. It's difficult because then once you kind of wrap this another layer onto your smart contract for your NFT project to actually enforce royalties, it's typically like you know, pointed for maybe one major marketplace or like partnership you have with a marketplace. And then when you, in order to like get listed or work with another marketplace, you have to then like do this integration all over again to have them adopt and work with whatever like wrapped protocol you have. So then you have a lot of all these marketplace having to adopt these new standards left and right, and then the project could choose a different standard for wrapping it. Just becomes quite difficult. And it's a good point to you know, about especially about, you know, like you face new challenges now as a project, I would say, whereas like in the past maybe you're still really heads down and building your community. But today I think people are having to like rethink how to, you know, generate revenue as a project, and it's quite difficult. I mean, even if you set for projects that like have lower royalties, you know, maybe they're not making as much, but now they're really making almost nothing if people don't choose to like respect them on marketplaces that don't enforce them, you know? But yeah, that's a definitely great take.
100%. Like, I just kind of want to like respond to that, because it's a tough position to be in, because say, for example, the solution that came out with Utes, right? Technically, the royalties are enforced, but now you can't transfer that NFT out of your wallet. And so if we're coming to this space with the idea of blockchain is permissionless, and I have to ask Metaplex in order to move my own belongings from my bag, then that's a problem, you know? And like, I give them, we're partnered with Metaplex right now. And, you know, I'm just like an honest and like hopeful critical thinker ultimately.
Yeah,
but
for sure.
That is something that is going to create a lot of friction. And if we've seen anything with this whole FTX fiasco, is that one person should not own the keys to all of the assets that are entrusted by millions of people, you know? And that's the bigger problem.
That's the same thing I was going to compare it to, sort of, right? Because, I mean, we're talking about NFTs, we're talking about royalties and kind of, you know, all marketplaces have this like centralized aspect, right? It just feels a bit decentralized because like once they enforce it, that's the way it is. And then everybody can just buy and sell and list their NFTs on that marketplace. But it starts to become a bit more complex, like you're saying, when you wrap that contract and then now it's like tangled and maybe you cannot like move it out of your wallet or you have other, like you can't, let's say maybe like list it with other marketplaces now that you have this partnership with also, you know, like Metaplex you're saying. And so, you know, the analogy here, the parallel that we're drawing, right? And the sort of concern with this from, and not to go like too deep, but from like a centralized finance perspective is, you know, we're obviously saw the major, you know, fallout with FTX recently that they're all a bit shocked about, and everybody is weathering that. That's, you know, the reason why a lot of people in the space are building like decentralized finance, you know, like permissionless blockchain solutions and ways to, you know, create things in a more decentralized manner. So you don't have to have you know, bet on any one entity, sort of like with your project or something like that. Yeah, so that's definitely a good take. And then I think we have maybe just like another question. At this point we're getting close to sort of maybe like in the last hour up here. I was thinking if people want to come up on stage, so we might just like go through like a few of these other questions and just like, you know, speak about them and see what people think. If anybody wants to come up stage, please request, and you can just like dive into the conversation with us as we're, you know, continue talking about royalties. Please don't feel shy. We're all just like in the same room together. So please like come up stage, or, you know, I'm just going to start picking on people and asking you to come up and nag you for your opinion, because I want to know what everybody's thinking in the room about royalties and what we can do, like, you know, to push the space forward, especially in like Web3, and with royalties, this plays like a major part. So I definitely want to get people thinking about it in the room as well. So the other thing I was going to ask you guys is about if like one day, like in the future, let's say, like, I don't know, every marketplace. So, you know, like, I know, like, right now there's still marketplaces that respect royalties. And I'm just playing like a devil's advocate and sort of like a dystopian future, just for fun. But like, if royalties cease to be like honored, what would you do? You know, and I know you're facing a bit of a challenge now, but, you know, people can still choose to respect them sometimes. But let's just say for your project, you can't have any royalties. What would you do? What's your game plan? Like, let's just say that, like, I snapped my fingers today and that happened. Like, what are you doing? What are you gonna pivot to?
Well, there's just no royalties. That's it. I mean, it's just, you know, one of the benefits we enjoy, and I believe we're supposed to have, but if there is no such a thing, well, then there is no such a thing. In the end of the day, it's like there is so many different roads you can go and build so many different things based on so many different aspects to it. It's crazy. I mean, NFT can be way more than just a JPEG, and then the royalties can be so an essential part of it as well. But it's always good to, you know, have access to these additional resources. But if there is no, it's okay. It's fine. You're going to find another ways, do another things.
Yeah, and start to, I guess, kind of get creative, right? You know, it's definitely tough, I think, even like thinking about a future where there's no royalties at all. It's, you know, you think about like a project, you'd have to even have like a very strong business model, even from like an NFT perspective, and for your product roadmap to maybe even initially, like, let's say, like, get investment early on. You know, for sure. Which is tough, especially. And I know, you know, Q, you're already talking about it, like, you're, you know, starting to think about other like revenue generating activities, right? In a time where maybe you never thought it would come to this. You know, I never thought Utes would send to 0%. I never thought, sort of, you know, Chicken Little said the sky would fall. You know what I mean?
Dude, yeah. I mean, like, facts, 100%. I think that it was definitely a bit of a whiplash when that all happened, just because of how I realized how much one marketplace could really dictate the entire market. And it was a bit, you know, ultimately, I really think that for us personally, I think it was always very clear that we were going to need to generate revenue. We were never necessarily like a super hyped up, kind of pumped project. We were more so niche, patient, and just passionate. And so ultimately, what I've like come to realize is that Particles isn't an NFT project. It isn't even necessarily a company, right? Like, it is a nonprofit. And the people that we've attracted into our community are very kind and passionate about what we're doing. And that's what they've always cared about. They're not necessarily like the when floor go up type of people. And so we've done a really good job at building products that keep them happy and give them value. But ultimately, we're branching out, and we should be branching out, because I feel like our audience isn't necessarily in the DGen community right now that currently exists. It's actually out in the real world, and it's with people who, again, are already in this very, you know, niche, artistic kind of like mind frame and mindset. And so that's why we're opening up a Solana Spaces in Salt Lake City, Utah. And it's going to be a gallery and cafe where we're going to be able to sell physical goods as well as artwork that people can take home, put on their walls. And we anticipate that that's going to generate revenue. But ultimately, my vision for Particles is for it to be a 501c nonprofit, and for people who care about the artists and kind of this new era of like liberating artists, in which they own their IP, they're able to monetize off of themselves, they're able to live from their artwork for the first time that I've ever seen in history. We're going to give a avenue for people who care about that already, you know, more than set, can give and also receive that value on the back end where they can write it off their taxes. And we get to focus on the real world and showing people how this artwork is tied to real people who are living right now in this world. And you get to make a giant impact with them.
Is this Breaking Alpha? I didn't even hear about your thoughts about opening up Solana Spaces.
Yeah, we announced it at Breakpoint Lisbon.
Oh, okay. That's awesome.
Yes, it's going to be really fun. It's going to be cafe, hipster vibes, good music, open mic nights, and it's going to generate revenue, but that's not ultimately like my goal. Like I'm not driven by money, truthfully. Like I'm building my own company and I'm going to make a lot of money with that, but ultimately money is just energy, and what you use your energy for will define who you are. And so that's why I want to keep Particles pure. I don't want to raise venture capital for it or have any other parties that are incentivized to kind of like steer the direction of Particles other than the artists themselves, because that's who we truly represent.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day, if you're not supporting creators and people aren't passionate about like what they're making, then, you know, like what's the point? You know what I mean? Like you can't just be in it for just the money. You have to like enjoy what you're producing. You want other people to like appreciate like your hard work, and you know, create something that like resonates not just with your community, but like other people that are like, oh, like that's really like an incredible piece of work. Like, how'd you do that? Like, what's the process? So it's really cool to like see you just continue to like push the boundaries a bit and bring that to real life. You know what I mean? I remember looking at, you know, just a lot of like the VR rooms, like the art galleries. So Solana Spaces has definitely kind of brought that, you know, that real life element to some like this digital work, but being able to like actually display it and showcase it. And for people who don't know about it, and to like see what they think is definitely really cool for like in real life communities, I'd say.
Yeah, I'm excited. They're like pieces that have like, I can't show them to their full credit in a virtual gallery because it's literally meant to be printed out on a artwork the size of a wall because it's so intricately designed. And that's that, you're completely right on that. Like, we need to have that bridge that allows people to see how real this truly can be.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's still just minted on the blockchain and transferable. Somebody has ownership over it, but you can showcase it in a way like never before. And you know, I think that's really unique and special, and especially, you know, being able to transact with it on like the blockchain. It's just like a new experience in this century that I definitely didn't like anticipate a lot of people being so excited and like passionate about this space. You know, NFTs have really shaped Web3 and blockchain in a way that like we never anticipated before. So it's just really amazing to see. I just wanted to give a reminder, people. So we have 5 minutes left. I think we're gonna end the space then. So I just wanted to make like a last call for anybody out there in the audience, anybody up on stage. I know we have we brought up Step in Europe. We have talent up here.
Talent up here.
Do you guys like have questions
for Victor or Q?
Feel free to ask anything
we discussed up here.
Hello, Joe. How are you? Nice space. Thank you.
Good. How are you doing?
Good. How are you doing?
Nice. Thank you. I'm working on the one NFT project, and we have some creative approach with the royalties, and I wanted to share this with you and ask what the professionals think about it. So we had the mainly two ideas. So one was to share the royalties with the holders whose NFTs are not listed on sale. Do you understand what I mean? For example, percent goes to the NFTs that are not listed on the marketplace. And the second approach was to use some part of the royalties to buy floor NFTs for the project, which can be sent to some funds or burn or something. I'm just curious if anyone used to use this kind of tokenomics for the NFTs with the royalties. It will be hard done with the Ethereum, but this type of approach I saw on some NFTs on Solana, but mainly during the staking and locking periods, not with the royalties.
So it's interesting.
I
see what you mean a little bit. I'm not like 100% sure, like what that model is. I don't know if it did you. Do you want to chime in on that, Victor? What were your thoughts?
Yeah, I wanted to say that about the second approach that you're thinking with buying up the floor price. The thing is, that's not organic. And what you're going to do is you're going to allow the paper hands to go out of the community wallet. The people who are actually not caring about the project to make them money, which is, you know, in the past, I saw that's been working right now because people are more mindful about how do you spend the funds. I don't think so it's the best approach to be buying back the floor with the community wallet. It may be if you do it with your own wallet, with your own funds, and then you just store it forever. So like some of the supply goes off. Okay, that's a nice thing. But if we speak of the community wallet and using royalties for that, I mean, you better organize fun events and activities for your holders giving these royalties away other than buying back the floor. Because now people will have something to do. They will actually have fun. They will enjoy it. And I mean, people that will want to be a part of this community will just start to attract the floor price, going to be moving on its own. Yeah, there is certain things you shall be doing, you know, in regards to the floor price and incentivize people to hold and everything. But that's not in the sense of buying back the floor. That's not going to bring actual value neither to the project, neither to you, neither to the community. So if you want to benefit the community, use these funds for something else other than buying back the floor. That's what I can say at this point.
Yeah, I appreciate the opinion. Okay, I think we're just about wrapping up at the end of the space.
Yeah, just real quick, interject here one second? I was listening to Victor, and I always appreciate Victor's opinion on stuff. He's such a force to be reckoned with in Web3. huge inspiration to me, but I had thoughts as you were speaking, and maybe I'm out of the loop here on what's going on with royalties, but you know, the question was asked, what do we do if royalties just gets wiped out, right? Like, at that point, why are we even in Web3? I mean, why not just go back to selling real-life prints and, you know, just go back to Web2? Because there's no point in having Web3 art if we cannot make recurring royalties. That's, like, the major point, you know, on top of actually being able to transfer legit ownership of a digital property. I get that, but royalties is like the big draw for artists, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point. And on that, I was going to add, I really thought that it's very similar. It's like music, right? It's like streaming your rights for artists and like sharing on platforms, you know? So if you're not actually getting a percentage of like by licensing some of your music to other brands, let's say, to use, then like how are you going to make money as an artist?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, to get rid of the royalties, you're taking a massive step back in the innovation of Web3. Just that doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and that's, I think, what we've learned from the current players in the space, is that ultimately they're not necessarily on the same boat as artists are. Like, they're not necessarily aligned with artists. But if you to give some kind of like consolation and like just reason to not go too, you know, too worried about the loss of royalties, is that if you actually look in the independent artists marketplaces, none of them have gone to 0% royalties. Any independent creator who is making artwork that they want to mint on the blockchain can still do so with royalties enforced on both exchange, form function, and that's not going to change anytime soon.
Yeah, it just really it kind of annoys me a bit if I sit and think about it too long, because there's so many people who are claiming to be, you know, Web3 innovators, but everything that they're doing, you know, here they are, they're trying to brand themselves as a platform that's basically a corporation that is maintaining, you know, bulk ownership of what they're doing. They're, you know, raking the community as much as they can, as much as it's tolerable in the market. And that's Web2 thinking, right? I mean, like, the whole point of Web3 is getting away from those corporations that are raking us all the time and allowing ownership of the, you know, by the individual rather than these entities that are owning, you know, transactional economics. It's just, it's crazy thinking to me that here we are trying to get away from Web2 and we're actually sinking into Web1 even. It's wild.
Yeah, I completely resonate with you, Talon, because there's this quote, and I don't know if I'm saying it correctly, but it's like, to be sane in a mad world is to be insane to the rest of the people around you. And I feel like ultimately we are in a mad world, and the fact that they can do this to us really has shooken our like fate in whether or not this space is even real to begin with. But in that environment, like, I think you have to, if you're sane in an insane world, you have to fucking lean into it. You have to keep going. You have to be okay with people calling you crazy and you going against the grain if you really want to see this through. And so I'll give you guys a little bit of alpha as well, right? So there's this artist, Adam Ape, and he's like made the A24 logo, one of the most prominent artists. And he essentially wanted to get his collections delisted from Magic Eden, and they refused to do so until he sent a DMCA, which is like a paper that you can send to Magic Eden that says, hey, you're using my IP without my permission. I need you to take this down. And so we've proven that it works for independent artists on Solana. And now the next experiment that Particles is going to undertake is to determine, like, A, we incorporate Particles and we say, hey, Magic Eden, as a collection, as a founder of this organization, you are misusing our IP rights and actually get delisted from Magic Eden. So again, right? there are solutions. It's not going to be easy, but if we really want to see this through, I think that there are very clear paths to get to the point where we can make a statement ourselves as a community, as a people, to make ourselves heard.
You know, Talon, there is one more thing I wanted to say real quick, is that actually, you don't even need any of these marketplaces. In fact, you can create your own, like, right now. It's going to cost you a little bit of Ethereum for gas, a little bit of understanding of what you need to do. But within, I would say, maybe 5 hours, you would be able to create your own marketplace, like, from zero. Knowing nothing, just having, like, 0.1 ETH. So speaking of the future, I believe that there's going to be more marketplaces that are going to be a decentralized marketplaces that eventually going to come. But then there's two sides to it. If you are a regular user, you won't kind of have somebody that got to be a third party so you can have a customer support and et cetera and everything. So if we're going to do a decentralized marketplace, I'm sure there's actually some, just don't know their names, then there's going to be no customer support, and everything that done by you is on you completely. They have nothing to help you with. There is literally nobody that actually taking care of it. It's decentralized. And that also got to be, you know, a minus and a plus. The plus is that there's no central entity in control. The minus is that there is no moderation. There is no customer support. So do you want to see a bunch of horrible things that are happening in the world on the platform? Of course you don't. Of course you don't want to see a hundred of another scam fake collections of yours. And to a certain degree, there is supposed to be some level of control because we do want to, like, a safe future. But decentralized marketplace is eventually going to be a thing, I believe. But I don't know how they got to solve all these issues as well. But in case if, like, all the marketplaces where you're selling your art, you know, do not appreciate the royalties and do not reinforce them and make them optional or just cancel them to zero, which is not going to be the case with a lot of marketplaces. The art marketplaces are going to stick paying the royalties to artists, and they're not the ones that started all of that. It comes to the bigger volume and to the PFP collections and everything, thinking of traders. Art is not for trading as much. It's just not the same class. So the art royalties are safe, but in case if they do change anything, you can just create your own marketplace for real. It's like you don't even have to worry and rely on OpenSea if you don't want to, and going to cost you not so much.
That's a good idea. It's like a good take. I'd say is maybe like a potential alternative solution. Let's say right in terms of you know, battling the front if you're facing the adversity of having nobody respect like your royalties and the marketplace you're listed at.
So
I believe CryptoPunks actually on their own marketplace. Sorry, Talon. Yeah, go ahead, bro.
No worries. Yeah. So I just kind of want to summarize. I think what Talon said kind of hit me. I just want to say that I think it's very important that the industry right now is going through this debate while we are still very early on. Like, we have not even reached global adoption to a scale that we want at this point in time. So while the industry is still very nascent, I think it's very important that all these debates surface, because each time one of these roadblocks are overcome, it will make it easier for the Web3 community to onboard Web2 users. And there are always going to be people that will find ways to circumvent the rules. So it's important that we have this discussion while we are still early on in the industry.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, because things are going to keep evolving and people are going to keep innovating. So it's, you know, I'd say important to place, you know, a lot of focus and attention on this like ongoing, you know, debate and even challenge, I'd say, like for creators moving forward. So that's it. It's a great point, Marcus. And with that, we're a bit over time. So I just wanted to wrap up and add a few closing thoughts on this discussion, this space, everybody here today chatting and talking about what they're working on and also their thoughts on royalties today. So the first thing I want to do, I just wanted to announce the winner of the 300 GMT giveaway that Moore was hosting. So the winner is at Crypt33 or CRPT33. Please DM the Moore account and also Stepan, or we'll tag you and we'll DM you by the after the Twitter space. But congrats on the GMT. That's awesome. And we just wanted to say, you know, thank you everybody for coming up on stage today to discuss about your projects, like how you started in the space as NFTs. Many of us, you know, for those who haven't been in the space as long as a few of us up on stage, and Solana or Ethereum, just, you know, a big shout out to like Q and Victor and Stone Tigers up here to share their story, how long they've been here, and just like give like a nice round of applause for them as well, just like being here and continuing to push the ecosystem, like building Web3, and being here. So we really appreciate it. Without like creators, without artists, without people producing work in this space, you know, I don't think NFTs would be anything. And with that being said, it was an awesome discussion. I appreciate having everybody else up here. Beth, Stepan, you're up. More, Marcus, Talon, appreciate your questions and everything else. Thank you very much. It was great to entertain some of these thoughts and ideas about royalties. All right, Victor, I see you have one more thought. Okay, I'll entertain it.
No, I just wanted to say thank you, everybody, for joining us today. I also just picked the winner is Jana. I already replied with his Twitter picker link down below. So just send me your wallet address. I'm going to send you a tiger. And yeah, awesome. I appreciate you for the space, Trevor, man.
Yeah, absolutely. I appreciate you having up here. Thanks for doing the giveaway. And, you know, thank you to Q and Particles as well. So have a good rest of the day, everybody. And definitely come to check out more on our launch pad if you haven't seen it already. We're still accepting submissions for PFP collections. If you've already created one or know some creators, feel free to let them know. Reach out, DM the Moore account or DM me personally, and I can help you launch your first PFP collection on Moore.
Thanks for hosting, guys.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a pleasure. All right. I'll see you guys later. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Good morning. Good afternoon. Good night. I'll talk to you soon.